All righty. Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for being here today. My name is Jonathan Gonzalez Montelongo. I'm the Visitor Services and Events Coordinator in our Campus Tourism Visitor Center. I work for Orientation and Transition Programs. So really, Coyotes Connect is here to help you transition as you continue to make decisions, but help you transition into college as you make decisions of where you're going to go, and hopefully it's going to be here. Today we have an amazing presentation by our College of Arts and Letters. So for any of those, any of you who have a major or applied with a major in the College of Arts and Letters, or if you're just here out of curiosity, right, if you're thinking of double majoring or minoring, that's also something that you can do here and pick up one of the majors in this college. So my pronouns are he, him, and his. I will be here throughout the presentation in the chat answering any questions that I can. If you have any questions about the program today, we will probably make the recording available online afterwards. So I'll be happy to make that available to y'all if you want to go back and kind of review the presentation. But without further ado today, I'm going to pass it over to my colleagues in the College of Arts and Letters. Starting us off and kind of leading this presentation is David Brady, a communication specialist in the College of Arts and Letters. David, please take it away.
All right. Can you verify that you can hear me? Can I get a big thumbs up that you can hear me from anybody? Jonathan, I'll take one from you. Can anybody hear
yes,
me?
Okay. I can all hear right. you.
Wonderful. All right. Well, welcome, everybody. We are delighted to be with you here tonight. We are probably not going to answer all of your questions because there is far more than we can tell you about the College of Arts and Letters than we can fit into 60 minutes, but we will try. As Jonathan said, hang on a second. I need to figure out how to advance my slides. Not a second. My name is David Brady, and I am the communication specialist for the College of Arts and Letters. I am a CSU graduate myself. I graduated with a double major from Cal State Northridge. I majored in journalism and then decided to add filmmaking as a second major. I've been with Cal State San Bernardino for almost a year. I'm coming up on my 1 year anniversary. I started my career as a reporter for the Los Angeles Times out in the San Fernando Valley, close to where I went to college. But most of my career was actually spent in public relations. I spent 14 years with the Walt Disney Company in Florida, PR in their theme park division, also some internal communication, some social media, a lot of fun grand openings, a lot of celebrity stuff. I launched and used to host the official Walt Disney World podcast, used to do a lot of celebrity interviews, a lot of fun, kind of big, splashy events, then started to do some internal comm with Disney, did a special temporary assignment, grand opening, the launch of one of their cruise ships, Hong Kong Disneyland, a whole bunch of things. And then I went to work leading the PR at Legoland Florida. So I've had a lot of fun jobs. So I can tell you right now, I would not be working for the College of Arts and Letters if it wasn't fun. You know, what I was looking for in this role was the opportunity to tell fun stories about great creative people, creative professionals like our faculty, you know, amazing creative talents like our students, our alumni. So what excites me about this role is getting to tell the story of the College of Arts and Letters. I'm very delighted this evening to be joined in that effort by my colleague. Let's see if I can figure out how to introduce her. Please give a warm welcome to Dr. Perestu Faizarangalam. But as we know and love her, we call her Dr. Faiz. She will be joining us throughout the evening, and she will be leading the question and answer period later on. I believe we also may be joined by Arturo Gonzalez, one of our professional advisors, who primarily supports the liberal arts majors. So I posted some information about Dr. Faiz in the chat. She is quite an accomplished professional. I am delighted also to tell you that in addition to serving as our current interim associate dean, she is also the current recipient of the university's highest award for teaching, the Golden Apple Award. So she has a very, very distinguished career as a professor of English at Cal State San Bernardino, has published 2 books. It's just a very delightful person. So you're going to hear from her later on. Dr. Faze and I work for the Dean of the College of Arts and Letters. That's Dr. Rayling Chuang. She is a longtime professor of communication studies at Cal State San Bernardino. She's been with the university for about 21 years, I believe. She was made the dean in June, this past June, after serving as interim dean for about 2 years. But primarily, she has been a professor, like I said, of communication studies, authored books, is delighted to welcome you all tonight. Is, you know, sorry she can't be with us, but you're going to hear from her a little bit. We have some videos to play for you. So let's talk about what we're going to discuss tonight. Oh, and a little bit of housekeeping. If I could just ask some basic Zoom courtesy, if you could just please mute your microphone if you're not speaking. You know, you don't necessarily have to use the raise hand feature. Feel free to type your questions into the chat. I might get parched once in a while, so forgive me. But please try to hold all your questions till the question and answer period at the end, as you'll see on the agenda. So this evening, we're going to talk about, well, what is the College of Arts and Letters? What makes up the College of Arts and Letters? It's not just our academic programs. It's not just the degrees we award. We also have a radio station, a museum. What's new? What is new in the College of Arts and Letters? And that includes something that I know is on everybody's mind, something that's very new, and that's COVID. How have we been dealing with COVID? We're not going to shy away from it. We're going to be very honest and transparent with you tonight about how we've been dealing with it in some very creative and very innovative ways up until now, and how we expect and are actively planning to return to in-person coursework in the fall, presuming the circumstances permit that. We're also going to talk about what's next. We have some amazing news to share with you about some things that you're going to hear a lot about within the next couple of years that are going to have an incredible impact on our programs and our students. You're going to meet many of our faculty. We asked our faculty to record some short videos talking about the courses they teach, some of the way they approach their teaching, some of their research. You're going to hear directly from them. And finally, we're going to take as many of your questions as we can. Like I said, we may not get to all of them. We may not have the answers to every question at our fingertips, but we will leave you with some resources where you can email questions afterward, or websites where you can go to, social media. We also have a podcast, which I'll tell you about a little bit later. So let's just dive right into it, right? What is the College of Arts and Letters? Well, you know, I could tell you, but I thought it would be simpler to tell you in a way that better reflects our college, right? We are a college of actors, writers, performers, musicians, thinkers, right? So you don't want to just hear it from me. We thought there would be a much livelier way to present this information. So I am going to mute my mic, and you're going to be hearing all about what the College of Arts and Letters is and what makes us so unique. So with that, I'm going to move ahead and mute.
The College of Arts and Letters is a dynamic and caring community of students, faculty, staff, and alumni united by a passion for the arts and humanities at California State University, San Bernardino. Our college includes the departments of Art and Design, Communication Studies, English, Liberal Studies, Music, Philosophy, Theater Arts, and World Languages and Literatures. We're also home to the student-run Coyote Radio, which spotlights the Inland Empire's best music around the clock, Coyote Advertising, an award-winning full-service creative agency, and the Robert and Frances Fullerton Museum of Art, better known as RAFMA, one of the region's most acclaimed cultural centers. The College of Arts and Letters cultivates creativity and critical thinking in students, enabling them to communicate new forms of thought and expression that build on global traditions in arts and letters. We are committed to cutting-edge scholarship, visionary creative artistry, innovative teaching, digital literacy, and community engagement. We educate the whole person, preparing graduates who are reflective, ethical, and collaborative. We are artists, actors, authors, makers, musicians, mentors, creators, composers, communicators, readers, writers, scholars, storytellers, thinkers, performers, explorers, doers, designers, and leaders. We are the College of Arts and Letters, and we define the future.
So that's a little bit about us. That's who we are. That's what we do. Like I said, we are not just the things you learn in the classroom. We are the museum. We are the advertising agency. We also have a PR agency. We have a student newspaper. You know, like I said, the college itself has a podcast. So there's so many things that make up the college and make it unique. So let's move on. What's new, right? What are some new things that are happening in the College of Arts and Letters? So I want to talk about just the news we generate. As you imagine, you know, we do a lot of things. We're very busy. So we have an office on the university called the Office of Strategic Communication, and they cover us quite a lot. So I'm going to show you just a montage of some recent headlines, just to give you a flavor of kind of the stories that we produce on a regular basis. So after COVID, our museum went virtual. They've done amazing things online, right? We have a lecturer who has brought amazing people into his classes through Zoom, a former White House press secretary. Wouldn't have been possible if it weren't for Zoom, right? We have an alumna that uses her English degree tracking down cyber criminals, right? Something you wouldn't expect to be linked to the College of Arts and Letters. We now offer a criminal justice Spanish certificate. We recently introduced a Coyote Mariachi ensemble last fall. You can study video games. That is a real thing. You can get a PhD studying video games. We also introduced a brand new minor, entrepreneurship in the arts, right? Don't sign away your master's. All right. This is something that you might have heard about. It happened
this
about a year and a half ago.
Inside CSUSB, your number one source for all things Cal State San Bernardino. The CSUSB Orchestra, made up of students and faculty members, experienced the musical adventure of a lifetime when they performed at the world-renowned Seoul Arts Center in South Korea. The trip was sponsored by the Shin Il Foundation. CSUSB President Tomas Morales led the delegation as they met with Korean officials from Seoul Cyber University. Music Department Associate Professor Lucy Lewis conducted the orchestra concert, featuring a mix of classical works and folk songs from around the world.
So obviously that was pre-COVID. That was, the performance was in October of 2019, but that was a huge, huge boost for our university. Many of those students had never been out of the country. I believe some of them had never flown on an airplane before. So it's just an amazing opportunity. And what was so great is we were actually able to have a documentary crew follow the students, not just when they landed in South Korea, but literally the year leading up to their trip, all the rehearsal, all the practice. So we actually have I believe it's a 28-minute documentary on YouTube called Flight to Harmony about that whole journey. It's really, really amazing. But I want to tell you, so in the spirit of what's new, I want to tell you about something that's even newer that has been an incredible opportunity for our college. So we were very blessed to have, we're very blessed on an ongoing basis to have incredible faculty. That's a given. One of our faculty members is an incredible artist, teaches in art and design, right? She was invited to, in effect, be the celebrity judge on a reality program that is currently airing on Netflix. It's a program about glass blowing. And I guarantee you, if you never cared about glass blowing, if you never knew anything about glass blowing, this show will hook you, okay? So in the first season, they approached our professor and said, because you're such a known, you may not have heard of her, but you will know her after this video. You are such a known, you know, figure in this field. We want you to be our celebrity judge. We want you to be our Heidi Klum, right? That was great. So she got a lot of publicity, brought a lot of attention to Cal State, the Cal State program, Cal State San Bernardino, our Master of Fine Arts program. Season two, they asked her back. And in season two, they actually had one of our alumnas of our Master of Fine Arts program competing as a competitor. So you're going to actually see, you know, how much exposure, you know, this program has given. We have been tweeting and posting on Instagram, hashtagging. We have gotten more exposure on our social media channels by tagging into this program than anything else we've posted. So with that, please enjoy. I'm not going to tell you how the competition ends, but all episodes are available now, so you can binge them. And I highly recommend it. It will be time well spent. Oh, wait, hold on.
Ten timed challenges meant to push your creative limits and test your technical abilities. At the end of each challenge, we expect that you present us with a piece of glass art that blows us away. If you don't, will ask you to leave the hot shop. Each and every time, you'll have to impress our resident evaluator, Catherine Gray. Catherine Gray is a celebrated glass artist, as well as an influential curator and educator.
Catherine's a badass. I'm a little scared.
She has this virtuosic skill. She's an icon.
During this competition, you're gonna get hot, tired, frustrated, glass will shatter, and so will some of your dreams.
Yeah, okay. I'm making this flower and a bowl of glass shards around. The bright flower represents myself, and the glass shards is the shell that I broke through to get to who I am today. Nice! I'm not really angry, but this is part of the process. My flash?
Now, what are we going to learn about you in this piece?
So, I've been working on myself for the last couple of years, and now I feel like I finally love myself. I accept who I am. But what also makes me unique is the process that get me here.
I had a lot of anxiety. I was like, okay, let's find a way to be happier with who I am.
So I wanted to not just represent the pretty flower, but actually I went walk through the shards to get to the flower and then the journey that I'm trying to represent.
Good luck. Looking forward to seeing your results.
Thank you so much, Kathy.
Right. So this is what she was creating as the challenge in the first episode. So yeah, as some of you, mentioned, enormous honor. And I'll be honest with you, now the competitor you were just saying, they don't identify her as one of our former students on the show, right? But she does when she gives interviews, and she says it on her website, and we've been tagging her and we've been posting, and the show has been reposting it. So, just that little boost of kind of hooking on to the buzz around the show without them having to sort of overtly say, yes, she was one of Professor Gray's students. And hang on a second. Did you like how they introduced our professor onto that show? Catherine's a badass. I'm a little scared, right? I mean, how cool is that? We literally turned that into a meme on Instagram, that quote, Catherine's a badass. Right? I mean, yes, it was an enormous honor. And Catherine is every bit of deserving of that reputation, the way they introduced her. So let's talk about something that, again, like I said, that's on everybody's minds, right? What about COVID, right? Right? I mean, you're literally doing this over Zoom, right? We're not trying to hide that. I'm not on campus, right? I'm in my bedroom. So we're not going to shy away from it. It's been a huge disruption, but you're going to hear that we approached it in ways that reflect who we are. We're artists, we are performers, we are writers, we are thinkers. So we approached COVID in a creative way. It did certainly disrupt some of our plans for the winter 2020 semester. Things had to be canceled hastily, but we rolled with the punches and we moved on. And I wanna show you that. Now, the great thing is we are hopeful we will never have to do this again, right? We are planning through the CSU Chancellor's Office to return to campus for in-person coursework in the fall, assuming that the circumstances allow that. But that is our hope. So I want you to hear the journey we've been on, how it hit us in the beginning, how we adapted, and kind of how we're moving forward. Another video.
In a matter of weeks, COVID-19 overturned our lives, our families, our sense of security. And we know that we will continue to live in its shadow for years to come. Well, it may be easy to say we're all in this together. I recognize that the individual impacts are painfully unique and impossibly to measure with statistics. So please, don't let it define your future.
We're making the best of it, and certainly it's not the same. We want to be in the same room together in real time, but we're artists and we're not going to be stopped, so we're going to find a way to collaborate and make music and make art and spread joy, especially in a time that we all need it so badly.
Many have asked the question, and actually today, what has sustained us during this most difficult of times? Books, absolutely, but not sports. Even now that they're back, sort of, the crowd noises are canned like a bad sitcom. It's been performers, actors, musicians, dancers, singers, comedians, drama students, performance artists, people slipping on ice. It's been great clowns and aspiring talents. Some with really, really good technology, some with just a camera. Almost all of them alone, trying to touch us, to make us smile. Creativity finds a way. You can't stop us, and you really wouldn't want to. So here are a few examples.
I wish I could go back to college. Life was so simple back then. What would I give to go back and live in a dorm with a meal plan again?
I wish I could go back to college. In college, you know who you are. You sit in the quad and think, oh my God, I'm totally gonna go far.
How do I go back to college? I don't know who I am anymore.
Candy, 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 I always want some more. Candy, 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 oops, I spilled some on the floor. 2 pounds, and you can't beat the prize. $5 a pound, 2 pounds, $5 a pound. 5 times 2 is 10.
We have to distribute this candy fairly between us.
Yes, we to have an equal number of pieces.
There, Micro and Nano each get 5 pieces.
So I will be honest with you, you know, when I started editing that video, it was heartbreaking, you know, and I was there when they were canceling those performances. But the more I put the pieces together and heard the words of our dean and our chairs, you know, it's a story of resilience. And so it really made me proud that, again, I hope we never have to do this again, you know, but it really did make me proud to see how we've adapted. So I have one more thing to show you in this sort of COVID segment. You may have noticed in that last segment, there was a singer who kind of put her fist up in the air, and she had a mask on, but it had a little clear plastic. That's actually from a production that is in the works right now. It's our opera theater group. And they actually sing from behind those plastic masks. And I had one opportunity to go on campus in the past year. And I heard them rehearsing, and with my eyes closed, I would not have known they were singing from behind a mask. I really would not have expected that. So this is a trailer for an opera that they are producing. Now, normally they would have staged this opera on campus in our, performing arts building. They would have sold tickets and it would have been a live performance. Well, right now, COVID doesn't allow that. So they're actually turning it into a film. And they're not just filming it on the stage on campus. Portions of it are filmed on location, as you'll see. And they're going to stream it online. And I believe they're going to figure out a way to monetize it. Because again, we really do rely regularly on the ticket revenue we get from those live performances. So something we've never done before, but we are so thrilled to be trying something new. It's an incredible opera. It's written by a modern composer who's still alive, who is active on social media. So you know we're going to be hitching on to that. It is called Song from the Uproar, and I believe the rest speaks for itself. So please enjoy. One more thing. I put this out of order. This was just to talk to you about how the Chancellor's Office has announced as early, you know, a couple months ago that they are prepping for us to return to campus. So hold on, I promise the fun stuff is next. So, like I said, it's actively in post-production now. We hope to release it as soon as late March. So look for that. It will get a lot of publicity. We hope to get a lot of news coverage because, again, it was totally produced under the COVID safety precautions. All the different adaptations they had to make to be able to record, to be able to rehearse, to be able to film. So now I want to talk about what's next, right? There are some amazing things coming. So I'm gonna show you one video that talks about probably the biggest piece of news. There are other things happening, but this is probably the single biggest piece of news that's going to affect the College of Arts and Letters. Not only just the permanent college and our faculty and our staff, you know, for years to come, but certainly our students for the next, you know, several decades to come. And the impacts are gonna be felt as early as this year. So watch, and I think you'll see we've got an amazing future ahead of us. So if you know the campus, that's the site. It's going to be kind of diagonal between the existing Performing Arts Building and the current college bookstore. It'll be right on that large grass lawn that kind of looks up toward the Pfau Library and the hills beyond. A beautiful, beautiful building. It's actually being designed by the same architectural firm that designed the new, well, not new so more, about 10 years old, the Performing Arts Center at Cal State Northridge in the San Fernando Valley, where I went to school. And that is what's next. So now I'd like to introduce you to our faculty. Dr. Faze was very kind to reach out to many of our faculty in all the different departments and ask them to record a short video. So these are the folks that heeded the call. They're all captioned, so it should be easy to kind of follow along with them. It's all different disciplines. They all kind of approached it a little bit differently, but I think it kind of gives you a good flavor of the type of faculty we have, the type of, the different creative ways they approach teaching and the different eclectic things that they teach that you might not expect. So enjoy, I'm just gonna go take you through them one by one. So I am going to mute myself.
Hi everybody, I'm photography professor Thomas McGovern from the Department of Art and Design. Welcome to Cal State San Bernardino. I hope you come over and take some photo and video classes with us. We have a big digital photography and video lab, a lighting studio. We even have analog photography. That would be like traditional black and white and alternative processes. We also publish a great magazine of student work every year called Dot Photo Scene, and we'd love for you to be part of it. And on top of that, we have a new certificate program as well as a minor in photography and video art. So these are all lots of great opportunities for you. So I hope you come over to the Department of Art and Design and take some photo and video classes with us.
G'day, my name's Dr. Kate Simonian. I teach creative writing in the English department. I primarily teach the writing of fiction and nonfiction. In particular, I like to teach genres of speculative writing, such as horror, sci-fi, fantasy, and magical realism. But I also love realist fiction. I particularly like feminist, experimental, and long-form fiction. I'm particularly passionate about working with students, especially students who are interested in becoming writers and teachers themselves. I do a lot of this work through the brand new CSUSB Creative Writing Club. So come check us out and welcome to the Yodi family.
Hello, I am Peter Robichaux, Chair of the Philosophy Department here at Cal State San Bernardino. I hope you'll consider taking some philosophy courses. Our department offers a wide variety of courses: environmental ethics, the philosophy of race, truth, lies, and bullshit, Latin American philosophy, Asian philosophy, the philosophy of law, human rights and global citizenship, the philosophy of hip-hop. When students evaluate our courses, they comment frequently on how important the class was to their lives and how it dealt with big issues in ways that changed their perceptions of themselves and their world. Our professors receive very high scores from students every semester for the quality of their instruction. We hope to see you in some of our classes soon. Thank you.
I'm Chad Luck, a professor in the English department. I've been here about 12 years, and I study 18th and 19th century American literature. So some of my favorite writers are probably people that you've encountered before. Edgar Allan Poe, Emily Dickinson, Frederick Douglass, these are the people I study. But in particular, I'm fascinated by the overlap between literary writing and political or philosophical ideas. What did early American writers have to say about the nature of democracy, for example, or citizenship? And how does that literary writing continue to shape our thinking today about everything from identity to ecology? I'm really interested in horror fiction and film. It's one of my guilty pleasures. I think and write about the ways that we experience horror fiction as readers and viewers. What does it feel like exactly to read a Stephen King novel? And why does it feel that way? And how do these feelings affect the way that we think about the ideas contained in the novel? I teach classes on horror fiction, on the American Gothic, and one on Edgar Allan Poe. Come check them out.
My name is Dr. Caitlin Creasy, and I work as a professor in the philosophy department at CSUSB. My research focuses on 19th century German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche, emotions, and the environment. My work on Friedrich Nietzsche focuses especially on the problem of nihilism or meaninglessness in his thought. I examine nihilism as a psychological phenomenon involving feelings or emotions that lead us to experience the world as meaningless. I also do research in the fields of environmental philosophy and the philosophy of emotion.
Hello, my name is Arai Mango, and I am a professor in the Department of World Languages and Literatures. I am specifically in the Arabic program. I'm a linguist, and so my research, I focus on language use, specifically the intersections between language, identities, and racism. I look at the language in the dominant discourse and how people position themselves within it and the meanings that they make from it. Specifically, I looked at experiences of Latinx youth. I looked at the experiences of Arab American youth, and more recently, experiences of teachers of Arabic in educational settings. In addition, I also conduct with students of Arabic and community partners. I do community-based participatory research And we do that with a local elementary school here in the San Bernardino area.
Hi, I'm Jasmine Lee. I'm an assistant professor of English here at CSUSB. I was born and raised in the Inland Empire, and I'm a CSUSB alum myself. I completed a master's degree in the English department in composition and literature before continuing on to my PhD program, and now I'm very proud to call CSUSB my permanent institutional home. As a faculty member here, I've taught courses on composition, on teaching, on writing and literacy studies, on the history of rhetoric, on affect theory or theory thinking about feelings, on young adult fiction, and on walking as a way of knowing. I'm currently supporting student research projects on a wide range of cultural texts like pop culture about witches, beauty influencers on YouTube, graphic novels, and more. I'm so excited that you're here, and I can't wait to get to know you and to see how I can support you in your research from here.
Hello, everyone, y bienvenidos a CSUSB. I'm Carmen Janney and the professor of Spanish and linguistics. I was born and raised in Switzerland, where I grew up speaking German and Croatian. So I grew up bilingual, like many of you. I've always enjoyed learning and studying languages. I learned Spanish at school, at the university, and during my study abroad in Venezuela and in Puerto Rico. My research is mostly on indigenous languages, and I work with the local tribes here in California and with an indigenous group in Oaxaca, Mexico. At CSUSB, I created programs and free textbooks combining Spanish with different professional careers, such as criminal justice and anything related to healthcare. When I'm not working, I like to spend time with my dog, Yogi. I hope to meet some of you soon. Welcome to CSUSB.
Hello, my name is Dr. Jessica Luck. I'm from the Department of English. My research interests are in the areas of contemporary poetry and poetics and disability studies. I'm interested in particular in the connections between the embodied mind and the poem. The genre of poetry has often been understood in relation to the rhythms of the body, such as the breath and the heartbeat, and to the acts of the mind itself. And contemporary cognitive science has lately been catching up to what the poets have been saying and understanding, revealing the ways that the mind and the body are deeply and inextricably connected and not separate. So I take an interdisciplinary approach to my research, asking questions such as, how do poems think? And how do they push back on our own ways of thinking? If a poem is or can be experimental, what are the experiments it conducts? Where do poems come from? That is, how do they emerge from a particular poet's embodied consciousness and place in the world? And in what ways are poets with disabilities using their own unique body, minds, and experiences of the world to enable their distinctive poetics? I enjoy exploring these questions with my students in my classes that I teach and learning from my students as well. So I hope to see you in a literature class sometime soon, and welcome.
All right, I have one final faculty video to play for you, and it's a little bit different than the others. So I hope by now you have got a very clear sense that our faculty members are awesome. They are incredible. Amazing accomplishments, you know, published, you know, performances all over the world, recordings. So they occasionally seek our professors out for commercials to promote the university. So they actually featured a professor from the Department of World Language and Literature, one of our Spanish professors, and they built a commercial around her to show the incredible quality of our faculty members. So take a look. And she is, I'm proud to say, for the brief amount of time I was able to spend on campus before COVID, she was my next door neighbor and brought me an orchid within, I think, my second week on the job. And I returned by bringing her homemade cookies.
Hello, my name is Viviana Diaz. I am an professor at World Language and Literature Department. I love CSUSB and I am a coyote for life. I love working for CSUSB. I I've been, as you say, I've been working before in so many campuses and universities before, but nothing compared with the environment, friendly and supporting environment that we can find in CSUSB. When I arrived here, I felt so happy because my passion is theater. So when I arrived to CSUSB, I found the support in my colleagues, and not only my colleagues, through the college with the dean, and not only at the college level, all the way to the provost and the president. Like, for example, through Acto Latino, we have been able to go and learn directly from Cuban culture, from Cuban history. And the same thing happens with Colombia. Having the opportunity to participate in such a renowned international festival as is the Festival Alternativo de Teatro in Colombia, it was like a dream come true. So when they really tell us the news that we were invited to go to that festival, we couldn't really believe it. And that's the thing that I most love about CSUSB. They understand that the teaching is not only in the classroom. They understand that the teaching goes beyond those four walls, so the students had the opportunity to really learn and get a complete education.
We communicate in infinite ways. And CSUSB's College of Arts and Letters helps students refine their voice. Some speak through the rhythm of an instrument, others through the stroke of a brush, while some express themselves beneath stage lights. Others connect behind a radio mic. We articulate our thoughts on paper, convey creative messages through advertising, explore cultures and literatures from around the globe, and keep the past alive through our accredited museum. We are storytellers, teachers, critical thinkers, and the College of Arts and Letters gives you the tools to inspire the world with your own unique language. We define the future.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the College of Arts and Letters. I am going to turn it over to Dr. Faiz and Arturo to answer any questions. It looks like we have about 14 minutes remaining. I'm gonna post some information in the chat because again, I think we may run out of time and there may be some questions we don't have the answers right away, but please, I'm gonna let Dr. Faiz take over. And I wanna thank you for joining us. This has been fun putting this together. It certainly didn't show you everything there is to know about the college, but you know, COVID aside, we're a family. You know, we stuck together through this. You know, we haven't seen each other in a long time. But, you know, we take care of each other. We look out for each other. And, you know, we've got a great future ahead. So with that, please welcome Dr. Faiz.
Thank you, David. And thank you for that great presentation. Hello, everyone, and welcome to CSUSB. You've made an excellent choice by deciding to attend our university. And congratulations to all of you. As you saw in the College of Arts and Letters, we have excellent and outstanding professors. We have rigorous and diverse programs, and we have very successful students. So we hope that all or some of you can join our college or experience our classes and the fantastic mentorship that our professors have to offer. I'm here today with Arturo Gutierrez, and we're here to answer your questions. So Arturo, hi, and please go ahead and ask us your questions. Any questions?
And frankly, if you wanted to say anything nice about the presentation, you could type that into the chat too. That'd be cool. You know, if you just wanted to say cool things about the videos and what you saw, did you learn anything? Did you see anything you didn't know about? I mean, I hope you did. I honestly hope you saw something about the college you didn't know before today.
Arturo, did you want to say just a few words about our liberal studies program and the types of things that our students do after graduating from that program?
Yeah, I'll give the basics. And then I did see someone added a question, so you can maybe try to get to that one right after. So my name is Arturo Gutierrez. I am the liberal studies advisor. So Dr. Face, part of our, I guess, dean's office. David, thank you for the presentation as well. In terms of myself with liberal studies, it's primarily our teaching, elementary teaching, borderline middle school is kind of there as well, but primarily elementary teaching kind of field. So this is probably about a third, a little bit more than a third of our college majors as well. And yeah, most of these students will go into teaching, counseling, primarily education kind of fields. Special education teaching as well. There's different branches, different programs that we have. Any questions with that, you'd probably, you know, be the best person to kind of reach. In terms of if you're transferring or any questions before then, I mean, we probably, admissions advisor is probably the best person to reach in terms of how your classes are going to fit in and all of that. But when you're here, I would be your advisor, especially for those transferring in. Yeah, any questions? Let me know. How do I implement the integrated track into my major? So just since this one's on liberal studies, integrated track, I believe for liberal studies, this is a piece where you can actually work on within your undergrad, also add in the credential program. So you're working on your bachelor's for liberal studies, and the credential program is a one-year program towards the end of that undergraduate degree. So it won't be a two-year degree from the start because it incorporates your credential as well, but you'd probably be looking at 2.5 for more than likely, depending on what classes you come in with. As a transfer student, if you're coming as a first-time freshman, that's 4, 4.5 is more than likely kind of what you're looking at. But yeah, you get the benefit of being able to use them as an undergraduate fees, financial aid eligibility. It is slightly faster if you consider bachelor's and credential kind of as combined program. There's more questions, so Dr. Face, go ahead and try to get to those.
Yes. So let's see. There was a question about ETPP, which somebody asked. Let me see what the question was exactly. So is the English teacher preparation program the same as attaining your credential? No, it is not. So ETPP prepares you to teach English in secondary school, but it is not that general sort of credential that allows you to teach multiple subjects. So that's the difference. However, it is a very easy kind of program to go through because a lot of the courses that you take for ETPP, if you're in the English department, overlap with your requirements for English major. So then you will automatically be qualified to teach English in secondary school. Does that answer your question? Let's see who asked that question. Okay. And then was there, for specific studies, can you travel to certain places? Yes, absolutely. But we have to let you know that these trips and courses have been on hold since COVID, as you can imagine. But we're hoping that next year we can start those programs, study abroad programs, if that's what you're asking again. Okay. Let's see, I saw for Spanish majors, is there the opportunity to say? I believe so, but if you want a more certain response to your question, I would ask that you contact Professor George Thomas, chair of World Languages, and I forget what, David, do you happen to know his email address, George Thomas's email address that we can?
I'll paste it in the chat, I'll find it.
Okay, great, thank you. Let's see. Hello, I have love the, okay, question, I applied for a is that considered graphic design? I believe so, Mia, but again, I don't want to, because our curricula in, do you happen to know the answer to that, Arturo?
Don't think so.
Okay. Again, I would like to direct you to Professor Matthew Poole. So if David, if you could kindly paste Professor Matthew Poole's email address in the chat section, that would be awesome. He will be able to direct you to that. Okay, so having a question in having a degree in English, I also wanted to pursue journalism courses. Is there any information you could provide on that? Yes, you know, our journalism courses are offered by the Department of Communication Studies, and you will certainly be able to take some of your electives in that department if you're interested in that. So there are multiple ways in which you can sort of craft your curriculum so that it meets your specific needs. I am not certain, but communication studies, are you aware of that, Arturo, if they have a certificate in journalism?
I don't think there's a certificate, not to my knowledge. I would need to look into that. But I know, I think that was Jacob. He had asked something else similar to that, but he was before a question I think we kind of missed. Says, trying to get a degree in English. I didn't know what my degree could do for me. And based on presentation, there's a lot I could do with it. Are you still involved in the master's program as well, Dr. Face?
I'm not anymore, but of course you can always get a graduate degree in English. And if you're interested in teaching at the college level, you can teach with an MA in English. Or if you're interested to, you know, get a PhD, then you can teach in a variety of different institutions. As for what you can do, you know, our graduates do a lot of things. David had in the presentation an example of one of our graduates who is now a cybersecurity expert. And I think she used to work for Chevron for a while. I don't know where she is right now, but just the fact that she's able to analyze language so closely and so deeply allows her to be a really good analyst. So with acquiring some basic technical skills, she's been able to be a very successful cybersecurity expert. We have graduates who work in hospitals, they're communication experts. We have graduates who are now writing descriptions for various companies' products, and they make good money. So there's a variety of things that you can do with your English degree. And in fact, we do have a careers page in English. I would like to paste that here if I can find it. David, would you be able to, do you think you can find the English careers page in Post-it here as I'm looking at the other questions?
And then I did.
Yes, yes.
Thank you. Thank you, David.
Yeah, just give me a minute to catch up to you.
Okay.
I just saw a question probably related to me. I'll go into that one right now. I did add a link to the certificates that our our school offers. You could also kind of be working with that within your undergrad. And even after that, if that's not something you can complete. I didn't find a journalism one, but there are some related to creative writing and another one that was related to writing, public and professional writing certificate. So they're close in terms of that English area. And so that's something to look into as well. So Laura Martinez says, how many years to become an elementary school teacher? So generally what allows you to be an elementary school teacher is the credential program. So if you come in as a liberal studies student, let's say, and you are in your general, as a general program that we have instead of our integrated, you would work on your bachelor's degree. And after your bachelor's, you generally work on a credential. That credential can be done after your bachelor's at our school, different school, doesn't matter where, as long as it's considered a multiple subject credential program. There are exams you would have to go through as the CBEST, CSETS, but that is why some students will also pursue our integrated degree that a student had mentioned earlier. That allows you to kind of remove maybe four or five classes from our undergraduate degree and start filling in those classes with credential classes, and you get to do that a little bit faster, about one semester faster. So again, what allows you to teach is not just the bachelor's, but more specifically the credential program. You need to go through a bachelor program first. Our liberal studies program is really good for that because the degree is structured by subject area. So you have your English, your math, your science, your art, history. So all of that is part of our major. And that is what helps you prepare for the CBEST. Okay, I could not hear the types of tests. So CBEST and CSETS. The CSETS are the big exams that test for your content in terms of your what you teach, I guess. CBEST is something you can look for relatively soon as it has more of a general, like kind of high school exit exam that you may see, like you're just a writing passage, general math, like high school kind of math. So nothing necessarily that you're taking at the university level really is something that is like, oh my gosh, that's preparing me for the CBEST. The CSETS, definitely, yes, those would be more difficult. Have more difficulty, and that's why our classes prepare you for those exams. Okay, I'm getting another question. Integrated over the general track. It's your preference. Do I have to take both or just one? CBEST and CSETS will be required of you down the line. But integrated or general, it's gonna be your preference in terms of, Kimberly, enjoy your night. It's your preference in terms of, do you want, some students will go general because maybe just due to financial reasons, they need to work on their bachelor's, maybe be a substitute teacher for some time, save a little bit of money for the credential program, and then they come back to the credential. Other students are like, I wanna go straight through, I can do this right now. Depends on your personal circumstances with everything going on, you know, at home as well, but if you can just kind of go through it, I mean, integrated works. If you want to go to a different school for your credential, the degree after your bachelor's, then you can't do integrated because your bachelor's is being held until your credential is also complete as an integrated program. So it's gonna be just down the line. You can switch to be general or integrated. So if you've already applied as one or the other, you can switch to which one you're considered as a major. Once you're here at Cal State San Bernardino, I can help you with that once you're accepted or you're after orientation and everything down the line.
Can I just say one quick thing, and I hope Rebecca is still online. So Rebecca, you asked about ETPP and how long that will take. You can complete the requirements for ETPP as you are completing the requirements for your English major. So you really, it will take you 4 years. Both of those will take you 4 years. You don't have to stay on longer for your ETPP. That's it. I know, Jonathan, you're here to tell us that we're at the end of the road.
Sorry for being the bearer of bad news. Sorry, y'all. I know that this has been such an informative session, and thank you to all of you for putting this together for our students. If you can continue to put the questions in the chat, what I can do is always send the chat to my colleagues here and to David so that they can answer anything that might be left. But just to respect everyone else's time, I just wanted to go over some last minute things. We are going to be having additional sessions about admissions, about housing, about financial aid throughout the season. So our first Coyotes Next Step is going to be on February 26th, again from 5 to 6. There's going to be 4 different sessions, and then there's also going to be a session about housing and financial aid. So I'll send the link through the chat if you all want to sign up for any of those. After this session, tomorrow you will receive a survey around 6 o'clock this time. You'll receive a survey. You can hold off until you've completed all the sessions that you're going to be doing within Coyotes Connect, or you can fill it out tomorrow. But if you can provide us any feedback that you might have in that survey that you'll be getting. So your registration through the Zoom that you did today will be your check-in for today. So that's how I identify who attended and who did not. But thank you all so much. You have an amazing rest of your week. And again, thank you to all the colleagues in the College of Arts and Letters for today's session. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.